Doctor Who, Beyond the Doctor, Sleeper Agents by Paul Mars, read by Anneke Wills. What a long and confusing day it's been. Ben Jackson and I are accustomed to exhaustion and terror and arduous escapes. We're used to running for our lives and getting away in the nick of time. And the way the doctor operates, it's like there's never a moment for catching your breath between crazy adventures. It's almost as if he needs constant distraction. Flip the switch. Land somewhere new. Quick, look at the scanner screen. Everyone outside, come and look. Come and see. There's hardly ever a moment for thinking or quietly considering. And today, when that ghastly business with the faceless humanoids at Gatwick Airport was over at last and everything was put to rights, it would have been the easiest thing for all of us, the doctor, Jamie, Ben and me, to pile back inside the TARDIS and head off again into the wide blue yonder. But Ben and I had realised that some strange kind of fate had brought us back to the very same date that we'd first left with the Doctor, after we'd defeated the war machines. It's rather like finding a bookmark in a novel that you intended to return to someday. The book falls into your hand and springs open at the same page. Oh, yes, 1966. I remember, and I have the rest of my life on planet Earth to continue. How could I have forgotten? Then the doctor looks at you with that crumpled, friendly face of his expression as dark as stewed tea. He smiles, and he knows. He knows that he's lost you. You're about to go swimming back into your own narrow time stream, like sticklebacks released from a jar. And he wants to reason with you and protest. You've hardly seen anything yet. There's a whole universe out there. In that moment when his dear face fell and he smiled at us and said, "All right then, off you go." It was as if he was setting us free into the wild, as if we were injured birds or animals he'd been looking after for a while and now we were ready to be let go. In that moment, I could have sworn I saw a glimpse of the old doctor in his eyes. That blazing intelligence and that much flintier soul. It was almost as if he was saying goodbye to us as well. "It'll be good to feel normal again," Ben had said. And I think he might have hurt the doctor's feelings a little. "I mean, this place, it's normal," he bumbled on. The doctor just looked at him, as if he didn't believe there was any such thing. He rooted around in his pockets and gave us some money, a bundle of pound notes and a bit of loose change. It was always incredible what he produced from those pockets. And then we left them both, on the tarmac at Gatwick, where it was noisy and blowy. The doctor and Jamie waved us goodbye and then went off to find the dear old TARDIS, while we went to find a taxi, just Ben and me. Suddenly I had a feeling, a shiver down my spine. Even as we went through the terminal building on our way to the taxi rank, there was a man standing near to all the flight desks. He was smartly dressed and somewhat bizarrely holding a cat in his arms. I caught his eye and he held my glance. Then we were gone and getting into that taxi. I didn't say anything to Ben. We were too busy being awkward with each other. I was so anxious to make sure that my spare key was in its usual hidey hole. Meanwhile, Ben was paying the taxi driver with the doctor's money, and now he stood on the pavement laughing at me. But as I looked up, I saw someone else fixating on me. Yet another smart man, with a cat, standing outside the fancy shoe shop that was underneath my flat. I blinked in the late afternoon sunlight, and he was gone. The odd thing is, They were both very fine cats. White-haired, sleek and beautiful, just like my own Mr. Puss. But still, I didn't say anything to Ben. I just found my keys and let us into my flat. There wasn't a speck of dust anywhere. Of course there wasn't. I'd hardly been away. I put the kettle on and was half aware of Ben staring at everything in my flat. My Danish corner sofa, and the Conran cabinets displaying all my Italian pottery, and the Moroccan rugs hanging on the walls. Everything was so brightly, boldly colourful, I felt straight at home again. I suppose his own digs must be rather modest. And I'd barely poured our tea before we started our rather awkward argument. It seems amazing that we've come all that way through time and space only to end up having an argument. But somehow it's happened. One minute we were talking about how we'd been through this incredible experience together, and the next I feel like I'm being embroiled in a rather heavy conversation.
Of course, let's face it, Ben is saying. You'd never have spared a second glance at me, would you, Duchess? You'd never have given me the time of day.
I can't believe he's talking to me like this, after everything we've been through together. Ben, I gasp. And he looks like a little boy, like he's about to cry.
I'm sorry, he says, and his voice is all thick. It's a bit much, all this, sitting here. In your flat, in your actual flat, Paul. Where you used to live. And it's so lovely. And you've got such fancy things. Oh, Ben, you clot, I tell him fondly. Why should my having a fancy flat make any difference? Why should my having nice furniture and belongings mean anything at all?
He shakes his head.
Because it brings home the fact that we're from such different worlds, Paul. We always were, weren't we?
I stare at the way he's holding his china teacup and saucer, so carefully, like he thinks he's going to break them apart just by touching them.
None of it mattered when we were in the TARDIS, he goes on. When we were with the doctor, all that kind of stuff didn't matter at all, did it? But here, nothing will ever.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.